This reading is most appropriate, I think, for the season that we find ourselves in. And I would understand if there are some of us who are perhaps afraid as we hear that the second wave is spreading quicker than the first. More people are dying, and we do not know what to expect as January comes. We don't know who will still be employed. Will we be able to go to school? What does this mean? But also we are with reason afraid, will we be able to continue with worship? Will we be able to do the kind of things that we have always wanted to do? I want to take all that fear, that's the general fear that we all have, but we also have our own private fears that we are not able to share with people today that are known by ourselves, the kind of things that challenge us, that leave us wondering, God, what's going to happen next? And it is those things that I want us to look at when we look into the gospel today, and I will conclude with what we read from Romans. We have a story that I've often shared with you about this scandal of Mary, the mother of Jesus, and her older cousin sister. Theological historians would have us believe that Mary was somewhere between the ages of 16 and 18 when she fell pregnant. And you all know the scandal of that if a child would fall pregnant by the age. And in this case, Mary was to be married, and so she wasn't. And this was quite scandalous for this to be happening. And at the same time, we are told about the scandal of this 80-year-old cousin, Elizabeth, also falling pregnant. And for those of you who are senior citizens here, I think you understand what I mean. If someone was going to come to you and say, now you're pregnant, I think that would be some mean job. So we have this, but it's all set in a context of words that I want to use today that might seem like they are just words that mean nothing. When Mary is approached by Gabriel and told that this is what's going to happen, with good reason, she said, it's not possible. It cannot happen to me. And she gives the reasons that we all understand. It is Gabriel's response that I want us to work with today for our life going forward and see how we make that appropriate in Advent 4. Because Gabriel responds and says, for with God, nothing is impossible. That's a very strong statement to be made. For with God, nothing is impossible. We know when we are afraid, we are so afraid that we begin to say, I know things are going to go wrong because I can feel it in my blood. I know nothing is going to work out because the situation is such that this is exactly what's going to happen. If you listen to the news, the future is predictable, because we are being told what is likely to happen next week. And oftentimes it happens exactly like that. You are told something about your own life, about your own situation, about your financial life, about your family life, and it happens exactly like that because that's what we expect. So if I was to come to you and say, no, better things can happen, you would answer me like Mary and say, but it's not possible. Look at everything around me. Every sign points to the fact that it's not going to happen. So what does it mean when the angel of God speaks to you or to me and says, but nothing is impossible with God? Is that a true statement? That nothing is impossible with God? Yes, for Mary, we see the proof. Nothing is impossible for God. With Elizabeth, we see the proof. Nothing is impossible for God. But I think the answer lies in how Mary responds to that declaration that nothing is impossible with God. Because having heard that and having considered the limitations around her, having considered why it was not possible, Mary then responds to Gabriel and says, okay, let it be according to your word. Pretty much saying, God has sent you, so I am holding you answer to your own word. My trust is no longer in the impossibilities that I can see, but my trust is in what you have said. Because you have said so, so it shall be. And I think this is the difference between us And perhaps the naivety that we see in Mary. The naivety of Mary is like the naivety of a child. The naivety of a child is such that a baby would climb on the bed and jump. You know what they are hoping for? That you catch them. They don't know that you are hoping. At that point, they trust that if I jump from here, the other that's next to me will make sure that I don't get hurt. That's the naivety of a child that I want to bring into this story as faith that says, fine, because you have saved it, I am going to jump. I am going to trust that you're going to take care of the situation. I have told you, God, that it's not possible. What you are suggesting, what you are saying is not possible. I have shown you the reasons why. But because you have saved me, here I go. I'm going to jump. And I want you to see something about this jump. It is a jump with no safety net. You just have to hope that God is going to catch you. Otherwise, you're going down backwards. This is what Mary said. Not only is it impossible for her to fall pregnant, but there is scandal coming. She is aware. She will be leveled to what is about to happen. You would know the story that even the betrothed Joseph wanted to get rid of her. Because what she was saying was scandalous. But having faith in God is scandalous. Because you are trusting that the impossible will become possible. You are being stubborn in your belief in God. And this is what Advent is about. That Jesus is coming to remind us by his own birth that even for our lives, we have to be scandalous in our belief that what God has promised us will be, even if it looks impossible. What we have, what we are looking at, what the world is dealing with, is impossible. The people we trust are scientists. They are professors. They know what they are doing. The people around us who tell us how much we are failures and how much we are not going to succeed are people that have gone through life. They are experts in whatever it is that they are saying, either about the economy, about our families, about whatever. When they have spoken, for you to stand against that and say, but for me, I will believe the word of the Lord that says nothing is impossible. That's the faith of a child. It almost feels stupid to believe it. But I want to say, believing and trusting in God oftentimes feels stupid. Often feels like you don't know what you are doing. But if it is that we know that the coming of Jesus, this Advent period, the Christmas period, is about the restoration of hope in our lives, then we have to stand with Mary, the mother of Jesus, and say, we see how impossible everything is. But you are saved, for with God, nothing is impossible. I wonder if there's anybody who can feel what I'm saying. Imagine being able to step out into the world with a statement that says, for me, with God, nothing is impossible. Imagine how strong, how tall we will appear. Imagine if the devil wants to threaten us and say, but you are going to fail, this is not going to work. And you respond and say, but with God, nothing is impossible. You are shutting out whatever voices are trying to convince you that this is not going to happen. If in the Sizulinga, you are refusing to accept because God has saved it, because God has declared nothing is impossible. And so you cannot be afraid. You step out saying, the God of the past, the God of the present, is the God of the future. So because he's saying now, he knows how he will take care of it in the future. I trust. I'm asking you to join me as we join Mary, who says, let it be according to your word. We know everyone says what I'm about to do is impossible. Everyone has suggested that this situation is insurmountable. But God, you have said nothing is impossible with you. I believe, I trust, with faith, I jump on. And if anybody says to you, why are you doing something so stupid? You turn back and say, listen, nothing is impossible with my God. So this is going to be done. So I'm asking you to believe that for yourself, for your family, for your country, for your workplace, for any situation you find. find yourself in at the moment, even for this pandemic that we face. I'm asking to have this faith, the naivety of a child. Let us trust that as we jump, God, our parent, will catch us. For nothing is impossible with God. And this is why Paul then concludes his letter by saying the following. And so now to him who is able to establish you by the gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery hidden for a long time, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all nations might believe and obey him. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen.